Hey, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co., and this is News and Weekend Review, where we're going to be diving through a bunch of assorted news topics. We're going to be diving through a few games that we played, all the topic of the week, all the videos of the past week, all that and more, and of course, links and timestamps and all those things down below, so you can jump to whatever section is most relevant to you. Which section is most relevant to you? Let me know in the comments down below, which section do you actually watch this video for? Do you just hit go and just watch the whole thing? Are you here for a summary of the videos of the week? Do you not really care about that? What about the topic of the week? Sometimes it doesn't even show up, depending on how much news we have. Or are you really here for the news? And I'm curious. Just occurred to me to ask, because why not? But with that said, let's go ahead and dive into this, starting off with unfortunately sad news, which is Pearl Games is unfortunately closing. Pearl Games, basically, most famous for Twa, one of my favorite games of all time. They did Black Angel as well. I believe they did Black Angel. Now I'm wondering. I think they did Black Angel too. That was the spiritual successor to Twa. They've done, I think they did Gengopolis as well, which is an amazing game. They have a bunch of games under their belt, and the most recent one is Time of Empires, which I just got. I haven't even had a chance to play it yet. Like, literally showed up at my doorstep, and they're like, and now we're closing now. Sorry about that, which... It felt bad. It does feel bad. It still feels bad. But Asmodee basically acquired them, and then Asmodee took them, you know, in and acquired them, growth of the company, all that stuff, and then they unfortunately looks like they're shuttering the doors for whatever reason internally, and the designer or the owner, the previous owner of Pearl Games, is looking to retain their catalog somehow and possibly go into, you know, I don't know, figure it out. Hopefully we'll see more from Pearl Games. They have done some incredibly unique, very well done games. Again, Twa is incredible. I highly recommend you search it out if you can, especially now before it goes out of print, if it's not already out of print. Phenomenal game. And then Gengopolis as well. Both those are very, very clever, very different games that, like, if it was just for those two games alone, it's a very cool company. Very cool company. And it's unfortunate. It's sad to see them closing, especially if, you know, especially in that kind of light of, you know, hey, we're going to acquire you and now we're going to shut you down. It's not the best. And from there, we also have over here, we have Istanbul releasing a choose and write board game. So Istanbul, a great game that didn't really resonate with me quite as much at first, but then as I played it more, or more specifically, as I added in expansions, love the game. I adore Istanbul. I think it's incredible. It's one of my evergreen games that it plays great with gateway gamers. It plays great with, you know, regular game group. It has a lot of depth and accessibility going on. Phenomenal experience. They're coming out with a choose and write, which I will definitely play and also probably won't keep. Generally speaking, statistically speaking, if you look at main game and offshoot game, the offshoot games don't tend to do as well, and I don't tend to keep them. The main exception for me is going to be Isle of Cats and Isle of Cats Roll and Write, where I prefer the Roll and Write or Flip and Draw, Isle of Cats Flip and Draw. I prefer the Flip and Draw version over the original game, but for the most part, statistically speaking, you take good game, you make offshoot game, you're kind of trying to cash in on the good game, and sometimes they're pretty decent, but rarely are they, like, amazing and great. Again, there are exceptions. See Fleet the Dice Game, better than Fleet. Again, exceptions. Past that, we're going to go ahead and have Townsfolk Tussle. Townsfolk Tussle is going to have Foul Neighbors and Odd Jobs coming. Basically, they put an update out today that, you know, hey, today's when I'm filming this. They put an update a few days ago. That's when they put out an update a few days ago, talking about, you know, the new content, Foul Neighbors, the Odd Jobs. They basically have two expansions. They originally had three. They consolidated them. And they're going to be coming to Kickstarter. Let's try to close this thing. Why is this thing in the way? Give me a second as I try to figure out how to move this out of the way over here. But past that, we're going to go ahead and, what was I saying? Townsfolk Tussle over here. So they have a few expansions coming, and we'll figure all that out there. That's going to be coming soon. What's the date on this one? What's the date? We have it coming March 14th. March 14th, the expansion is going to be launching on Kickstarter. If you missed out on Townsfolk Tussle and you want to get your hands on it, this is the time. Although you'll obviously have to wait, like, you know, after the Kickstarter and all that. But at least you won't have to pay, like, $300 for something you can pay $100 for instead. I don't actually know what the price point is. I'm talking about the original crowdfunding campaign, not the new one. It is what it is. Moving on from there, we have Play the Game HQ. They put out a video this week, Play the Game of Heat, Pedal to the Metal, where you can watch myself, Devin, Meg, and Play the Game HQ playing through Heat. Pedal to the Metal from Days of Wonder Games. Additionally, later today, I'll have a first impressions you can watch on my channel as well, but we just play through the game. We talk about it. We play the game. Then later today, we'll talk about the game. All those things. Great gameplay. In general, Play the Game HQ puts out fantastic gameplays. Highly recommend subscribing if you're looking for that kind of, like, really in-depth vibe of, you know, multiple camera angles, real focus. They put out some real quality content. Worth subscribing to them if you like that kind of thing. From there, we have over on Board Game Geek, we have Renegade Games Acquire, and of course, because why wouldn't you at this point, Renegade Games Acquire from Prior Acquirer. Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, that's the title that basically has to be written once you have Renegade Games acquiring Acquire. Acquire is a game that's been out for a long time. It's had 17,000 different versions to the game, and now Renegade Games has acquired it, and they'll be putting out their own version of the game, which I'm excited for, because I think Acquire is a game that holds up. I think Acquire is a game that really is very solid as far as the cutthroat merging of different markets. For me, the only reason I ended up getting rid of it is I think Indonesia from Slaughter does it better, but the fact that I'm even comparing it to, like, saying, like, Indonesia, Slaughter game does it better, really should show you how well Acquire does hold up. It's clean, it's elegant. I've always said it's the game Monopoly should have been, which to me just means that it was a mass market game that was available, never really as popular, but had a lot more strategic depth. That's all I mean by that. But Acquire, Renegade Games acquires Acquirer from previous Acquirer. Then we have over here, we have, speaking of Renegade Games, we have G.I. Joe, two new expansions. More expansions for G.I. Joe content. G.I. Joe is going to be the new Heroes of the Grid kind of, this is a deck building game. I take it back. This is the deck building game. They have two new expansions for the deck building game, not for the new Power Rangers version of that system, the Heroes of the Grid system. Then we have over here Dice Tower West. Badges on sale now. Room block is open now. Basically, Dice Tower West is March 8th through March 12th in Las Vegas, Rio Hotel. This is going to be, well, obviously from the Dice Tower. They're going to have games, the giant Dice Tower West library. They're going to have panels. I'm going to be doing a panel there. They're going to have, I don't know, all the things you expect to see from one of these conventions over here. This is going to be my first time at Dice Tower West. Like I said already, I will be doing a panel. Still figuring out the people and the topics and all that stuff. But we'll deal with all that. But the reason I'm talking about it now is because they are going to be closing ticket sales, I want to say, February 12th. So if you want to get into this, if you want to, you know, go ahead to the convention and all that stuff, I highly recommend getting your ticket sales ASAP before they close out that. Apparently, they will be doing ticket sales at the door. I think Tom, if I'm not mistaken, said he'll guarantee you get entry, but it is 20% more. So if you do want to go to the convention, I recommend checking it out now, as well as obviously managing rooms and staying and all that kind of thing. But Dice Tower West, it should be fun. They're also, GameFound's going to be doing a hot games room, which means if you want to have the opportunity to try a bunch of upcoming games, there's going to be a bunch of fun stuff there. There's going to be, I don't know, what do we have here? We're going to have the upcoming and past campaign. So we have, like, Destiny's Witch War is going to be there. There's going to be some Tainted Grail, some Isis Vanguard. There'll be, I don't even know, what I'm trying to remember all the companies that are going to be there. There's going to be Endeavor Deep Sea is going to be there. There's more companies offhand. We're going to have Guards of Atlantis is going to be there. Bunch of companies and campaigns with a bunch of games you can either late pledge. Like, Guards of Atlantis is going to have an upcoming campaign on GameFound. And so GameFound's doing a whole hot games room where games that you could either previous pledge on late pledges or upcoming campaigns. Oh, Street Fighter V is going to be there. A bunch of games that you can go ahead and try out. And then, you know, either just say it's not for you or back it or just have it on your radar for the future. So if you want to check that out, Dice Tower West will have a lot of fun things happening. Highly recommend checking it out if you enjoy conventions and stuff. Past that, last thing over here we're going to mention is the fact that over here, a few weeks ago, I did a giveaway, giving away 6 Lacertas and Hopmox Victorum. This is a video that I put up, I don't know, 11 days ago, 14 days ago, 2 weeks basically from whenever you watch this, and this is a video just talking about, hey, I'm doing a giveaway where I'm giving away a bunch of Lacerta games once we hit certain milestones on the channel. Whenever it happens, no, not time sensitive, I don't care if it happens in a week, I don't care if it happens in 7 years, but basically once we hit 48,500, or is it 47,500? I have to double check the numbers. I think it's 47.5, 48, 48.5, 49, 49.5, and 50,000. We're going to be giving away a Lacerta at every single one of those milestones. So just on the way, just boom, 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 and you'll be able to see the winner in the week in review over here. All you have to do is head to that video and comment Euro. And then additionally, if you want to win Hopmox Victorum, over on Camp Co-op, where I'm playing through campaign games, if you just comment on a specific video there, and again, all the descriptions are in this video, then once we hit 2K subs, we'll be giving away Hopmox Victorum. So enjoy all of that, or try to enjoy all of that, but that's basically the giveaway, which brings us to the topic of the week, and finally the last link over here. Usually I close out the topic of the week, usually I close out the links before I dive into the topic of the week, but right now we have the topic of the week, which is Dominion killed replayability. This is an article that talks about how Dominion killed the concept of replayability. Dominion destroyed what replayability means. And let's go ahead and have that conversation now instead of dealing with it over here. So let's stop this, close this. Basically, what's the conversation? So the conversation at the table is that Dominion killed replayability. That before Dominion came along, replayability was the strategic depth of an experience. And then Dominion came along and gave you a variable card market. And you'd play the game with the variable card market. And then you'd mix in new cards, you'd have a new puzzle of a different card market, and you'd try to reestablish the puzzle of how to actually win with a new card market. And then we'd do that again, and again, and again, and again. It would constantly give you new setups and situations in a way that really, really reinforced the idea to gamers that replayability does not come through the depth of the experience, but rather replayability comes through a wide variety of content on the table. And if you've watched my videos and you've watched any of my crowdfunding coverage and you've ever seen me talk about a game and how I'm excited for expansions and player powers and variable this and variable that, then you know that I do like the variable stuff. And so this is a conversation I've actually had before. I don't recall if I've done a full dedicated video, or maybe it was another topic of the week. I don't really remember, but we're going to talk about it now, because I think replayability comes from a few different sources. I think replayability comes from the depth of the experience. I think it does, and I think it's amazing and fantastic, and I think replayability, in terms of being able to jump into a puzzle and reapproach it with like new lenses and new light and try to optimize around that experience, that can really enhance the gameplay, especially if you are fighting off against other players who are also iterating and growing with you as they learn how to approach that puzzle. And so you're always escalating in tandem with other players and growing your skill level and approaching a better way to approach a game. And there's one small caveat there, which is my problem with replayability. When replayability comes purely from the depth of the experience, I find that it inherently has an increased skill gap occurring. Inherently, if you and I are approaching the same puzzle, and it's the exact same puzzle, puzzle one to puzzle two, we're playing chess, for example. If we're playing chess, then as we approach that puzzle, as I play it more, I will get better at it because I'm playing it more. And as you don't play it more, that skill gap will constantly increase. Versus if the puzzle of chess, let's say chess, every time you approached it, had a random setup. Completely random setup, but it was just different. Or the pieces were mixed in and out, the different player powers as far as the pieces go. What would happen is, as you and I approach that game, my 7 plays over you would mean less, because I'm constantly facing a new challenge at the table. I'm constantly facing a new way to examine that. And so yes, I still have 7 plays over your 2, but there's a gap, the gap between that is lessened, because the replayability comes from approaching a new puzzle. Effectively, wider degrees of content give you replayability by reforcing a new puzzle upon you with the same constraints of the mechanical system. Versus not giving you that replayability, not giving the variety of content, forces replayability through the optimization of the experience. Anytime you are forcing a player to get better at a game through purely the optimization of the same experience, you are basically increasing the skill gap between players, and I find that less satisfying. It's not that I find it unsatisfying, it's just that I like playing a lot of games. And I also am the one playing the game, which means two things will happen. Games that have that skill gap, I will be destroyed in when I play others, because I'm playing a lot of games. And then within my own game group, the people who are playing less games than me are playing still a wide amount of games, but even less than me, and so I would beat them at these games. And so I appreciate the different ways you can approach replayability. I always have and I always will. There are different games and different things that I want in my system, but there are some games in my collection where I have them with the knowledge that I will play them with the same person again and again and again, because we are enhancing our appreciation for the engine at the table at the same time. And then there's times where I just want the constraints. Give me the puzzle. Give me the rule set at play, but then give me a different way to approach it. The different card market in Dominion, the different player powers that you approach in any single game, the asymmetrical player powers, the different setup, DEI, Divide et Impera, fantastic game from Ludus Magnus Studios. You're going to hear me raving about it a lot, just for the record. I'm currently in love with the game. But one of the things I love about DEI is that the setup of the game drastically changes the entire experience as far as how you puzzle through the same sequence. A lot of DEI is about how you manipulate the movement of the game, which cards and powers you get to be able to move up to different levels and across the board in different ways. And that puzzle is going to be the same if you use the same recommended setup every single time. The way you approach that puzzle might be slightly different, which cards you have, which faction you have. There is variability, if there's variability baked into DEI, even with the basic setup of the board. But the fact that you have a different setup every single time means every single thing is flipped on its head. That faction being optimized with that card, with that starting position, you can no longer do that. Now you have to reapproach the same puzzle. So again, you have all the piece information in your head, but every time you're reapproaching that puzzle because of the variability baked into how I can even start to approach the system. I think variability in games has different reasons to exist. Different aspects that make a game entertaining. I think there are things about games that are entertaining even if it's the exact same puzzle time over time. But the less things that mix up the puzzle, the more you're approaching that engine trying to find the optimal path. Not to relearn how to apply the optimal path on top of a new pathway, but rather you are just trying to find the optimal path. You hit a dead end, you try something else. You hit a dead end, try something else. You're constantly trying to just go from point A to point B and find the optimal direction given those constraints. Every additional facet you add along the way makes it so that the game is less about finding the optimal path between point A and point B, but rather it's about learning how to read a map instead. You're no longer getting from point A to point E, but you're trying to apply the knowledge of the system on top of the framework, and every single thing gets thrown in your way. if you've gone down a certain road 100 times and I've gone down it 0 times, of course you're going to know the better way to get there. But if both of us have driven cars and we're going down a different road for the first time, your knowledge of road A will give you some degree of benefit, but it won't give you nearly as much of a gap. I like replayability. I like variety. I like asymmetric factions. I like player powers. I like a dozen different things that change up the experience. I like Dominion. It's one of my favorite games of all time. I'm pretty sure it's in my top 100. I'm like 97% sure. Anyways, that's the topic of the week. And with that, let's go ahead and dive into what I played. As usual, for the past several weeks, what I played is no longer about every single game I played, but rather the specific games I want to talk about. In fact, the first one is going to be DEI, Divide and Impera. I didn't actually plan on bringing it up in the last segment. That just worked out nicely. But DEI, Divide and Impera from Lewis Magnus Studios. I am loving this game. I am sorry, expect content, expect videos, expect shorts, expect it coming up in every top 10 list, expect a gameplay video. There already was a gameplay video. Expect content on this game because I am loving this game. Now, I talk about this in the short that I put up this past week. I'm doing more shorts these days, in case you've seen that. But anyways, I talked about it in the short this past week, but DEI, it's one of those games. Every year I have a few games that are standout hits to me. Every year there's like 5 to 10 games that are my 5 out of 5s, the games that I adore. And there wasn't any, I don't think there was anything in January. I don't think I had a 5 out of 5 in January. I could be wrong. I should probably double check. Into like, there's no standout hit for me. There might have been reviews that went up in January, but that's when I discovered the game's different story. But for me right now, DEI is currently, at the moment, currently DEI is my game of the year. It's early. It's early. Hold off. Just, we'll got time. We got time. But DEI gives me area control, which is a genre I like, and it does so incredibly well, which makes it so, this is not going to be a review. I gotta stop talking about this game. There's going to be a review eventually, but I'm playing it more. I already have, like, I think 3 plays under my belt, which 3 plays is not a, you know, game of the year make, but 3 plays certainly puts it on a pathway where if I'm feeling this strong about it right now, and every play only further solidifies how I feel, that's a good sign. DEI gives you area control and powers and abilities and asymmetric factions and variable setup and all those things that make the puzzle so fascinating. And it's a game that rewards you because it's about area control more than it is about killing other people. There's some degree of eliminating other players, a small amount, but it's a very minuscule amount. If you've played other games, I don't know, well, Innis has a lot of bloodshed, Cycladus has a lot of bloodshed, Kenna has a lot of bloodshed, Rurik, maybe it's a bit more similar to Rurik, even Rurik has bloodshed. DEI possibly is the least bloody area control game I've played, even compared to El Grande. I think El Grande has more killing of other units. So it's really focused on the area control. It's really focused on the resource gathering. It's focused on all the various components that add up to a delightful puzzle of a Euro game, a Ameritrash-style hybrid game of a game with a ton of player powers and a ton of expansions. I have 4 boxes full of expansions I am excited to dive into. They may all be terrible. Sometimes it happens where a game is amazing and the expansions don't add much to the experience, but I don't care. If the expansions don't add anything to the experience, this game is already well worth it. I'm loving DEI. I think it's absolutely fantastic. It is a great, great game that I couldn't resist talking about, even though I'm kind of spoiling my review. The more I talk about it before I do a review, the more it's like, well, why bother watching it? We know the opinion. But I'm sorry, I just want to talk about the games I love, and I like DEI quite a bit. The second game is going to be Solomon Kane, which is much more of a disappointment to me. Solomon Kane's not a bad game, not by any means. This was from Mythic Games originally. They sold it off to Monolith. But Solomon Kane is a larger campaign exploration game with like different chapters and books you're going through, of different stories you have, with choose-your-own-adventure elements as far as how you approach it or how well you approach the various puzzle. And I thought it was totally okay. I liked it, don't get me wrong. I actively like it. I guess for context, like, I was playing through it more, and I was like, let's play through it more. And then I was like, let's play DEI, and I played through DEI, and then I was like, let's not play through Solomon Kane more. I enjoy Solomon Kane, but it's a game that I liked playing, and I don't feel the need to own. The gameplay for Solomon Kane basically gave me a small amount of mechanical decisions and a lot more focus on how the story will develop around you. So it kind of gives you guiding structure, a little bit of mechanics, a little bit of these arcing, like, you know, spirits, not spirits, angels, whatever they're called. I can't remember they're called. Forces, some things, auras, they're called a thing. But they're in the background over there helping guide Solomon Kane as he makes choices. But most of the game felt it was very mechanically light with not a lot of agency around what I do mechanically and more agency as far as the choose your own adventure aspect of how I engage with the world. Which is not bad, but I already have games that have that and I think games that I think were easier to get to. I'm going to compare it mentally to roleplay adventures in the sense that roleplay adventures, I'm there for the story and I'm not there for the mechanics, even though the mechanics are pretty decent. And I think it's a fair comparison to Solomon Kane based on the experience I had with it so far. Although I think I prefer the mechanics of roleplay adventures slightly, but I drastically prefer the story of roleplay adventures and I find it easier and more accessible. Solomon Kane has lots of decks of cards and a lot of things to go with and a lot of things that kind of get in the way of how simple and accessible it could be. I enjoyed it. I like it. Would happily play it again. Don't feel the need to own it. And lastly, we have TDO, the Titan Defense Organization. This is going to be an upcoming campaign over on GameFound, where this is from King Raccoon Games. And this was a kind of King of Tokyo plus, but cooperative. It's got a very light feel to it as far as how you take these characters, and they're trying to defeat this titan who's marauding around the map, destroying cities, and you roll your dice, and you allocate to your dice certain abilities, and I enjoyed it. I'm going to be diving into it more. You can expect full coverage on it. I had small complaints, and some of the complaints I have, I know they're already looking into. I don't know what will change, and there's some thematic complaints around the nature of the center map and all that. But overall, it was just fun. It was a fun game that it felt like, hey, if you have 45 minutes, you just want to roll dice and take down the baddie in a way that's going to be variable because, you have a variety of characters, you have a variety of titans, different things that mix up the experience. I enjoyed it. I really thought it was a very, very, it felt very cooperative, felt very teamworky. I think, again, my biggest complaint is some graphic design stuff in the center board. I think if they can clean those up, this is the kind of game that I would go to when I want something like Marvel United, when I want something like King of Tokyo. It is on the lighter side, but lighter side with choice, with strategy, with elements of just enjoyable dice rolling and dice allocation. I like dice allocation, and there's opportunities to feel clever. There were some really fun moments in the game I played already that have, just one game so far, where there's some really fun moments of assigning dice in different ways, two different abilities, and comboing things up to have some really satisfying turns. I like TDO so far, and we'll see how that continues and develops. And with that, let's go ahead and dive into the videos of the week. Videos of the week, starting off with this past Saturday, where we have The Adventures of Dex Dixon, which was an okay game. I gave it a 3.5 out of 5. I enjoyed what The Adventures of Dex Dixon is doing, but to me, it's in this weird space as far as, first of all, thematically, I'm not pulled in by it, but it's kind of, ultimately, it's a skirmish game with powers and abilities and a lot of things going on as far as you're accomplishing your goals. I thought it did some things really well. It was a Kickstarter that I don't think is funding, unfortunately, so we'll see what happens as far as relaunch or this or that, but a solid game with a lot of solid mechanics behind it and a theme I don't like, and I guess mechanically I think I prefer some other elements of different games instead, but overall still enjoyed it. 3.5 out of 5. Later on Saturday we had The Search for the Lost Species. Great game. I give it a 4 out of 5. This one takes all the things I like about The Search for Planet X and just makes it better. A better theme, better mechanical changes, mostly the same game. I would say if you like The Search for Planet X, I don't think you need The Search for Lost Species. It's basically the same game with small improvements. It's kind of like going from one zombie side to another, so it's like, it has that aspect of, yes, there are good things happening here. I would say unless you feel the need to get it, you can probably pass on it if you already have Search for Planet X. Both of them are great games. I do prefer Search for Lost Species, but not like, oh my gosh, you have to get this. Your Search for Planet X is still going to be a great experience anyways. And who knows, maybe you even like that one better. Then on Monday, that's not true, then on Sunday we had games leaving the collection for January. A large call list. I basically was going through a ton of backlog, just putting out like things I was planning to get rid of, but they hadn't made their way into other videos. I just basically dumped them all on the table. There's a bunch of upcoming games and reviews that I haven't done yet, so you know in advance that I'm not keeping them. Doesn't mean they're not good. There are many great games that, like, for instance, let's say Search for Lost Species. I don't know if I need it. I think it's great. I think it's really solid. I just don't play deduction games that much. And Tiwanuku, I think, is my favorite deduction game. And I don't know if I need another one in the genre right now. So we'll see. But either way, the point is that great games do leave the collection. Take that into account. But anyways, I did a Games Leaving the Collection video. You can check that out. And then over on Patreon, I give some of those away. So you can check that out, too, if you are a patron. And then from there, later on Sunday, we had Should You Back Marvel United. This is a video series that I stopped doing for a bit, but it's back in vogue. Once a game hits 10,000 backers, generally, I have some flex as far as what will make me do it, but once a game hits 10,000 backers, I'll be doing a Should You Back It video, where I talk about whether you should or shouldn't back it, and why, if you're interested. You can check those out. They're just fun, deeper dives into a game, and I did a Should You Back It on Marvel United, although people pointed out correctly that I highly recommended the campaign decks, forgetting to note that you kind of do need a lot of the previous content on that. So that was definitely a boo-boo screw-up on my end. I think, in other senses, I think I covered everything great there, but I neglected to mention a disclaimer, the fact that I was like, yeah, this is the best buy ever on the new campaign, but it kind of requires having a lot of the other content, so there is that. Or being willing to proxy stuff in, so apologies. Then on Monday we had Two Back or Not to Back, where I got to make that exact apology and update for those who watched that video. But anyways, Monday's Two Back or Not to Back was going through a bunch of campaigns, going through Search for Lost Species, going through Dex Dixon, going through Marvel United, going through Batman over on GameFound, Andromeda's Edge over on GameFound, going through Sleeve Kings over on GameFound. There's more stuff on Kickstarter as well. A bunch of campaigns, left, right, and center, as far as just going through, whatever we had. It's actually a bunch of heavy hitters and updates, and then kind of a bunch of smaller campaigns. Not a ton of major players this past week. Some big ones, and then a bunch of smaller ones. Then on Tuesday we had a few videos as usual. We had a review for Stonesaga, or more for first impressions, really. Meaning I played, they gave us 3 gameplays to go through, or 3 whatever. I played through all 3 of these scenarios that I could go through. But then after that, there's just a kind of an empty void of the more content coming. So I need to see more of it. But overall, I really enjoyed it. Very promising. It has great exploration and discovery going on, I thought I was very impressed while also needing to see more to give a final opinion on the game. But overall, where it is right now, based on my gameplay, 4 out of 5, easily. Will it stay that way? That really depends. This is the kind of game that could absolutely drop. You know, you can get 5 plays in and find there's just no more discovery and nothing else going on, and it could just tank, because I'll say this much, to me, the game is about discovery. If you remove the sense of discovery from the game, I wouldn't want to play it anymore. And so that's the kind of weird trade-off, where right now it's very much first impressions. I enjoyed it, probably a 4 out of 5, but we'll have to see the final game to answer that for sure. Later on Tuesday, we had a review for Stellarion, the newest game in the Oniverse series. I like it, I enjoy it. Not as much as the other games, it's probably my least favorite Oniverse game, while still being a game I'll keep because they're small boxes and I like the rest of them, so I kind of want them all. And then lastly on Tuesday, we had a review, or more again, a first impressions for Homeworld Fleet Command. This is from Modiphius Entertainment. More of a first impressions here because there were like prototype issues and rulebook stuff that really dulled the experience a bit while still being an experience that I enjoyed. It gave me a great skirmish game, played through a bunch of games, but I kept having rules questions and having to look up this and try to find out if this is something that was or wasn't taught yet. They kind of taught the game in an iterative learn one scenario at a time, but then as far as referencing rules, it was impossible and I was very left in the dark at different points. So, and again, the rulebook at different points had just sentences or paragraphs or examples wrong. There was a lot of issues in the rulebook, and so that was an experience that I enjoyed. I had fun with it. I want to play it more, and I want to see more of it. But then also, it's one of my complaints was moving stuff around the board, and they have these nice trays in the Kickstarter apparently. So again, lots of good things over there, but not the best prototype experience. So I gave it that asterisk of first impressions, and we'll see. But overall, instinctively, the lowest it would be is a 3.5 out of 5, and it could well be a 4 out of 5, depending on how things iterated and whether those issues were not in the way. So it's always weird because I want to give an opinion. I don't want to be like, hey, I'm hiding an opinion behind, like, you know, this disclaimer. So that's my thoughts. I think it's a 3.5 or a 4, likely a 4. But we'll have to see the final game to know for sure. Then later on Wednesday, we had a Crokinole gameplay. So a video of basically me and Jeremy Tracy playing Crokinole for an hour and asking questions and talking about the game and his life and all those things. Tracy Boys makes the best Crokinole boards in the business. They're amazing. They're incredible. I highly recommend them. Later on Tuesday, we had the Weekly Live, which this week, I believe, and I say I believe because I'm filming this Tuesday night, so I don't actually know. But I believe we did more of a general Q&A, just myself and Meg doing a general Q&A, because Devin at the moment is currently traveling to me, not at the moment. Devin is currently here at the moment. He's right next to me wherever I am at the moment. But when I did that when we did the Weekly Live, he is currently getting ready to travel. And so just me and Meg this week. But I think we just did a Q&A. Maybe we did something else. I don't really know. We'll find out. You can watch that. And then lastly on Tuesday, we had a gameplay for DEI Divide and Impera, a game that I really like. I may have told you that, so we're going to move on from there. Past that, we have Thursday. Thursday was going to be a recap of the games played in 2022. Basically going through, here are the games I played in 2022. Kind of a recap video of all the games that really stood out to me as far as the new games that I did in 2022. That whole video series I did where I was like, hey, we're going to do 30 new games a month, whatever it is, a new game every day for the year. I was going through a recap, picking up the highlights, the best, the surprises, the worst, that kind of situation. So you can check out that video if you want. Later on Thursday, I might have done another video. There might have been a Play This Not That of God Tier versus Super Fantasy Brawl. I'm not sure if it's going up Thursday or not. So either that went up Thursday or some other point in the future. We'll find out. And then on Friday we had 10 games Board Game Co. needs to teach us. That's because it's from Meg and Devin filmed that one. That is just the two of them talking about, hey, Board Game Co., Alex, that's me. I don't usually talk in the third person, but that was their video title. But anyways, 10 games that I need to teach them, going through a bunch of games that they're very interested in, including games like Rurik and Teneris Adventures and a bunch of incredible games. They picked some really solid games, by the way. Overall, great list of games. I'm very excited to actually teach them. One of them I've already taught, and the other 9 are still to go. Actually, another one. I should be teaching another one soon, and then the other 8 are still to go. So hopefully we're down to 8. We got time. We'll do Rurik next. I want to play Rurik so badly. It's so good. Anyways, that was Friday, which brings us to today. Today we are going to have 2 videos as usual. We should have a Goblin Vaults review from Thunderworks Games, as well as a Heat First Impressions, like I mentioned already. That's the First Impressions video with Play the Game and Devin and Meg. Actually, Devin was taking a phone call doing that video, so just Play the Game, myself and Meg. And then coming up this week, we'll have a few things. First of all, I'm going to have a 12x12 challenge video going up soon, basically talking about a 12x12 challenge that I am undertaking of a bunch of games I want to dive into 12 times and see how that pans out. I'm already mostly done through one of them. I got more to play, but mostly done through one of them. And we also have a Best Games of 2021. This is one of those games, one of those things where I mentioned this in the past, but I'm doing slowly a sequence of videos where I go through top 10 lists from previous years or whatnot. So I'm going to be going through a bunch of, I'm saying this poorly, I'm doing a sequence of videos of 2021 games, 5 different videos, each with 15 games, each covering a different topic of those games. This one is the best 15 games of 2021. Basically, now that a year is settled, I want to see where things line up, and so I have disappointments, I have misses, I have games that faded, I have best games, and this is going to be the best games of 2021, according to me, from the games that I played. But then there's also 15 games I still missed in 2021, so there's always something going on. And then past that, that is basically that, which brings us to the games on the table. These are all, as usual, these are the games I hope to dive into this week. We have Galactic Renaissance, the spiritual successor to Inish. I'm so excited to play this game. We have Forged of Ravenshire. Just played this this past week, actually, and hope to be diving into this one again very shortly. Then we have over here, Cartouche. This is one from what's it called? I mean, who's this from? This one, Peter Hayward. What's the name of the company? Bluebird Entertainment. That's the one. This is a lighter polyomino game. I like polyomino games. I want to give this a shot, and I like Peter Hayward. Or I like Peter Hayward's games. He did That Time You Killed Me with Thanosaurus. Then we have Tragedy Looper. Hope to be playing this one. This is a new game from the new version of the game from WizKids. Very much looking forward to that one. And then lastly, we have Motor City. The Kickstarter just arrived, and I'm excited to dive into this one, a final production copy. Three Sisters is great. Fleet is great. I mentioned Fleet the next game already in this video. You see? Look at that. I'm already covering things. And with that, we're going to go ahead and call it a wraps. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate all of you. I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co., and I hope you have a good one.